For what he has done in our lives. And he says that, and now I brought this first fruit of the land, the first harvest, I brought it to God to show that God, you are the one that's given me these blessings. You shall set it before the Lord your God and worship before the Lord your God. And you shall rejoice in every good thing which the Lord has given you and your house and the Levite and the strangers amongst you. So, you know, I've told you that in many places we have been, when they pay the tithe of the offering, it's a big celebration. It's just like a thanks offering. Because they put the plates there and people dance from the entrance of the church till they get there, put the offering and they dance. Like somebody can take 15 minutes in paying that offering because it will begin to dance from the entrance. Dance, dance, dance. Some of them go around the church with the offering. They dance with them. Others dance around before they finally bring it. That's what God wants. To rejoice before Him as we show appreciation for what He has done for us. Whether it's your tithe, whether it's a thanks offering, God wants to dance. That's why we dance in the thanks offering. Of course, we can just bring it and just stay there and say, Lord, I thank you. No, God wants to rejoice. Show Him that you appreciate what He has done, that you are thankful to Him, you are grateful to Him. That's what God wants. And sister, that's why you have to rejoice in every good thing which the Lord your God has given unto you. Some people say, oh, what's there to rejoice in? Oh, there's a lot to rejoice in. The fact that you're even here today is a cause to rejoice. Do you know that many people slept last night, didn't wake up this morning? Do you know how many people were drowned last night? How many people died in motor vehicle accidents? How many people are sick? I mean, the fact that you woke up this morning, you can speak, you can walk, is enough to give God thanks. Don't wait till everything is perfect. Yeah, in the world, there's no perfection in this world. But what do we have? Thank God for it. Let's go to Philippians 4:4 and Ecclesiastes 3:12-13. Philippians 4:4. Ecclesiastes 12:13. So God is teaching us how to show. This is why they instituted the thanks offering in this church. It is because of this verse. God wants to acknowledge when God has saved you, saved your family, taken out of trouble, delivered you, you must show appreciation. Remember the 10 lepers who are healed? One, yes.
Philippians 4:4.
Yes.
Rejoice in the Lord always.
Rejoice in the Lord always.
Again.
Again.
I will say, rejoice.
Rejoice.
Let your gentleness be known
all
men.
Thank you.
The Lord is as one.
See, he said, rejoice in the Lord always. He didn't say, rejoice only when you have a promotion. Rejoice only when you have a breakthrough. No, only when you have money. No. He said, always. Always. When you rejoice always, God will always meet your need. Look at Paul and Silas. They were praising God after their backs were beaten and they were bleeding at midnight. That's when God answered them and delivered them. You see, many of us feel, I only need to rejoice when things are good for me. No, 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 no. You rejoice every time, even when things are bad for you. Say, let the joy of the Lord be your strength. You know, the joy of the Lord is not dependent on your circumstances. It doesn't depend on, oh, whether you do this or that. No. It's always, the joy is always in you, regardless. But second passage in Ecclesiastes 3:12-13. Ecclesiastes 3:12-13. Is Michael sleeping or is he awake? He awake? Ecclesiastes 3:12-13.
I know that knowing is better for them that should rejoice and do good in their lives.
That's it.
And also that any man should eat and drink
Yes.
And enjoy the fruit of all his labor. It is the gift of God.
It was Solomon says, rejoice before the Lord. So when we go to the next passage, how our Lord Jesus Christ was telling us of the kingdom of heaven. It's very important to know this. The book of Matthew, kingdom of heaven, Matthew 13, 44 to 50. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hidden in a field, the which when a man had found it, he hideth it, and for joy therefore goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. He's describing us what the kingdom of heaven is like. And, you know, this can only be meaningful to you if you've gone through this experience. He says it's like a man, when he found this kingdom, that is precious thing to him, he sold all that he had and came and bought that field where he found his treasure. Now remember the rich man that came to Jesus to ask for eternal life. And Jesus said, go and sell all you have and come and follow me. And the Bible says the man went away sad, for he had great wealth. See, his money had him. He did not have his money. If he was one that had the money, he would have given it off and followed Jesus. That's exactly what he's describing here. That when he found his treasure, he sold everything. He said, I'm going to buy that field because of what I found. That treasure is so special. So anybody who finds the kingdom of God will do anything to get it and hold it, because that thing is more valuable than money. And this is what happened in the early church. In the early church, everybody sold what they had and brought it, and they took care of everybody. Nobody said, this is my car, this is my house. No, everything I have belongs to everybody else because of what they know that that thing is to them. Let's go to Philippians 3 verse 7. Philippians 3 verse 7. It said he hided it, and for joy, in other words, he didn't tell anybody, because if he told everybody, somebody else was going to buy the field. He went, sold everything he has, and with that money, bought that field. So when you two find that kingdom, you will not mind selling everything to keep it, because it will mean more to you than all the money and everything else. Philippians 3, 7.
But what things were gained to me?
Yes.
This I have counted less for Christ.
Uh-huh.
Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ.
Exactly.
Jesus my Lord.
That is what Pastor Paul found. He found that kingdom. And he said he counted everything else as loss for that thing that he found. It's like he sold everything else and said, this is it. I don't mind losing everything else. As long as I have this, you know, this is not for me. So God just was telling us what that kingdom was like, and that many people have found it. Those people, worldly possessions mean nothing to them. If you are still holding worldly possessions, you haven't found the kingdom of God yet. Because no, God is more valuable than that. In any case, you can't even buy money. So again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant man seeking goodly pearls. You know, pearls are the only thing in this world that man cannot improve upon. What are pearls? They're precious things that the animals in the sea, they refine it and people collect them and sell them in jewelry, right? But pearls are perfect in the sense that you cannot improve on them. Those animals have brushed them and made them so clean, you cannot improve on them. It's like finding perfection. So this man found this goodly pearl. So when he found one pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, a similar description. Found something so special that he sold everything to have that one pearl. Proverbs 2 verse 4, Proverbs 8 verse 10. Proverbs 2 verse 4, Proverbs 8 verse 10. See, the kingdom of God is so, what he's saying, what I'm giving you is so special, that's worth everything else you have. Proverbs 2 verse 4, Proverbs 8 verse 10.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Receive my instruction.
Uh-huh.
And not silver.
Yes.
And knowledge.
Uh-huh.
Rather than
gold.
Choice of gold.
Gold. You see? Say, receive my